Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Cut the Clutter today is talking about two completely diverse things. A little bit about politics and a little bit also about one new manifestation or complication or fear that has come out of the COVID pandemic. So let's talk about what is scaring us even more first, because our politics doesn't scare us so much as entertains us. It's also a national pastime. Everybody is a political expert, if not a cricket expert. In fact, most people are both. So we'll talk about politics, maybe in the passing, in the latter half. So first of all, the new fear or the new phobia that has come out of the COVID pandemic. And I know all of you have guessed what we are talking about. It is this new talk over a rare disease called mucormycosis. Now, mucormycosis is a terrible fungal disease. It's a terrible fungal disease. It goes into our nose, our sinuses, our mouth, our palate, eats up our jaws, dislodges our teeth, can go to our brain, lungs. It's a terrible thing. It also has about 50% fatality rate. I will tell you the one good thing about it, which is actually quite good. So wait. It has 50% fatality rate. Also, its treatment is quite rough in the sense that there is a medication which you can give, and that medication sometimes works, sometimes doesn't work. It's also a medication with heavy side effects. And as I said, it may not always work. It's not a Ramban Dawai. So very often, medication also has to be accompanied by surgery. And this is not pleasant surgery. Also, it is surgery which may end up resulting in the loss of some part of our faces, a jaw, maybe the palate. In fact, it's the palate and the jaw that get blackened by this fungus. That's why the name black fungus for this. So often the treatment involves a whole lot of specializations. It involves pulmonologists, of course, because it's gone into your respiratory system. It needs microbiologists, particularly those who understand funguses, intensive care people, intensivists, internists, people who know internal medicine, then neurologists, also ENT specialists, eye specialists, and dental specialists also, because this is the area this attacks. And very often when it requires surgery, some of that surgery is what surgeons call debridement. Debridement essentially means that you open up a wound or see an open wound and take out the debris and take out calluses or hardened skin, etc., or what is called as hyperkeratotic skin in medical terminology, and clean the wound up. But cleaning the wound up in your sinuses, palate, brain, it's also very complicated thing, and very often this surgery ends up in the loss of some part of a victim's face. It could be a jaw, it could be the palate, it could be an eye, anything. So this is not a disease you wish on anybody, even if it's somebody you don't like very much, least of all on your friends, family, on yourself. Now, I told you there is one good thing about this disease. And that good thing is actually a very good thing. And that is that it's very, very, very rare. It rarely hits us. It's also something, it's caused by an organism, mycomycetes, which is present everywhere. So if I pick up a scoop of soil from this pot, chances are it will have some mucormycetes. It's available in the dust that we breathe, particularly dust in our cities, which are so dirty. It's available in lots of places in nature. It's part of our environment. So how come we don't get sick? We don't get sick with it all the time because we have our immune system. So our immune system deals with this. Our body is such a marvel. At any given point of time, it is dealing with millions and billions of bacteria, funguses, viruses, all kinds of things. In fact, our body hosts a whole bunch of bacteria, funguses, and viruses. But it's the immune system that keeps away, that fights what is dangerous. It also controls, it maintains the balance of all these guys. Or not all of these are bad guys, some of these are good guys. Our gut actually needs good bacteria. That's why when we are given antibiotics, these days good doctors also give you probiotics. probiotics increase the number of good guys in our gut. So the good bacteria in our gut, because when we take antibiotics, they kill bad bacteria and also good bacteria. But we need bacteria in our guts to keep our digestion going, to keep our system healthy. So remember, maybe 25 years ago, these probiotics only came in about 25 years ago, and you get this Neutrolin B and Enterogermina. I'm not giving you any prescription drugs. These are over the counter, legally over the counter. These are not even drugs. But before these came in, what would our parents tell us, or what would our doctors, family doctors tell us? They will say, beta, ye dawai khaoge, saath mein thoda dahi kha lena, teen baar din mein, ya chhach pi lena, lassi pi lena. Why? Because dahi also contains the same healthy bacteria. So healthy bacteria in our body control unhealthy bacteria. Similarly for funguses, similarly for viruses. So our body contains all of this. Now that is the reason that mycomycetes generally doesn't bother us. In all of India, you would find in a year maybe a few hundred cases, and that's why there are not many doctors who specialize only in this, because this is such a rare disease. Now, many people might have also had an experience, or might have known about somebody who had this experience, that if somebody is given a very strong antibiotic over a long period of time, very often you will find that while the antibiotic treatment is continuing or is about to end, fungal infections break out in the body. This can be oral or genital thrush, as it's called, candida infections as they are called, white kind of coating. And that is then treated with antifungals. That is easily handled. But why does that happen? That also happens because antibiotics then are attacking a lot of bacteria in your body. And again, the microbial balance in your body is getting upset. So if that can happen from within your body, can you imagine what can happen with long steroid use? In this case, it's steroids plus antibiotics plus antivirals. So all that has to be handled by a very experienced doctor. And yet, as I said, the good thing is this is a very, very, very rare condition. So God forbid, if you have COVID-19, even if your doctors put you onto steroids, don't start imagining that this has happened to me. Leave that call to the doctor. It's most unlikely it will happen to anybody, particularly if these basic precautions are being taken. But there is one condition which causes this disease to happen. First of all, you cannot avoid coming into contact with this fungus because it's part of our lives. That besides, what we know is the conditions in which this fungus is able to strike our bodies, which means kab iski himmat hoti hai. And that happens when our immune system is really weakened or compromised. Now that happens very often with COVID-19 patients, particularly those who are hospitalized. So they are, by this time, there are crores of COVID-19 patients. Even the official count is in crores. So not everybody is exposed to this. It is people who spent a lot of time in hospital or who've been on steroids for a long time. Now steroids, what do steroids do? There was an old friend of mine in medicine, a pharmacologist, when I used to report postgraduate medical institute in Chandigarh, who would say to me then that you have to understand that steroids for us are medical last rites. Not last rites for the human being, but medical last rites, which means when medicine has no other answer to a problem, medicine uses steroids. That is to buy time, that is to calm down your body's immune system. Steroids are also used for all kinds of autoimmune disease, even something as common as asthma. Budecort, that is now sold over the counter, that people take when they have asthma, has a steroid in it. Also for eczemas and things like that, but it is also used for very complicated life and death situations, as say with COVID-19, when it begins to affect our lungs. That is where steroids are used. Why are they used? I mean, we've done this many times, but we can always repeat a key chapter. Because your body finds a strange virus and your body starts fighting it, body gets really angry. So your immune system gets really angry. In the process, there is maramari and bloodletting, equivalent of an immune system fighting an invader. And at some point, the invader loses, invader dies. So our immune system is able to kill the virus, expel the virus. In most cases, 7 to 10 days, our body has expelled the virus. But what has happened, meanwhile, is that in that process, our body's immune system has got so angry that it doesn't notice that the virus has been expelled. So our body's immune system then goes around searching for cells anywhere, viewing everything with suspicion and going after it, just firing randomly. And that is what needs to be calmed down, because this is what then damages our lungs and continues to damage our lungs even when patients turn COVID negative. So this is when steroid therapies are given. Those steroid therapies have been the most effective in reducing deaths and hospitalization in COVID-19, in seriously ill COVID-19 patients or patients of severe COVID-19. These steroids are not for everybody. Now, if you look at the cases in India, and I am reading up Indian publications, Indian reports, what Indian doctors are saying in various places, these are coming in two situations. One, when there is a long period of hospitalization and a lot of steroid use, which means the patient is not coming under control, the patient's immune reaction continues to be very strong, and a lot of steroid is given. So what does a steroid do? It lowers your immunity. Along with steroids for COVID-19 are also given immunomodulators. These are also drugs like tocilizumab, for example. Many of these drugs were actually used earlier for other autoimmune conditions like, say, rheumatoid arthritis. These have been repurposed now for COVID-19. So the use of immunomodulators and immune suppressant steroids in high doses over a long period of time, because you're trying to save a life, can bring down the immunity to such a level that these environmental funguses can cause this infection. That infection is called black fungus or mucormycosis. Now, this other source from which this is coming is that because there's shortage of hospital beds, shortage of specialists, so word is spread that steroids work. And in India, if we have one common trait across the country, it is self-medication. We love to self-medicate, and now the availability of Google has made this disease worse. Also, everything is available over the counter in India. So you go and have your antibiotics, whether they are needed or not. You can also get remdesivir, get some doctor who you know to administer it in maybe his or her clinic or maybe at your home. So that's an antiviral. On top of it, steroid. And when you take steroids, they make you feel better. That's why we say, oh, so-and-so is having a steroidal bump, right? Or a share goes up suddenly, but you are not convinced that this increase in share price is justified. You might say it's a steroidal bump. So a steroid gives you a false sense of well-being. So you take steroid, then you say, I'm feeling better, so I'll take a little more. A doctor has to very carefully monitor the dosage of a steroid, and when they take it off, then they taper it. They don't immediately take it off, they taper it. Now, I've read up, you can also read up what these dosages are, but for heaven's sake, I beg you with folded hands, don't do it. Because steroids are cheap, but steroids are very, very strong drugs. They should only be used under strict medical supervision. And even the doctors doing this have to be very careful. They should know what they are doing, because you can make a patient feel better, but you should always keep in mind the other consequences and keep monitoring that. So a lot of people treat themselves at home. They take steroids at home, but they also start administering oxygen to themselves at home. Now, those oxygen instruments are not always very well cared for in terms of hygiene, and they can be contaminated with mucormycosis. And that is what causes a greater problem. And that's why many patients, by the time they come to hospital, already have this terrible complication. Now, many doesn't mean thousands. It's happening maybe a few hundred cases have been reported all over India. And again, all of them have this low immunity situation. There, you know, for every germ, every fungus to grow, you need a medium, right? After all, when a doctor pathologist takes out a blood sample and it's sent for culture, it is put in a culture medium to see which germs grow in that culture medium. So what is the medium in which this fungus grows in our body? That medium is sugary, because we know that anything sweet, anything sugary is very good medium for bad guys to grow. That's why mucormycosis especially and almost exclusively targets those with uncontrolled blood sugar, diabetics with uncontrolled blood sugar. And in India, diabetes is a lifestyle disease, but in some ways many doctors think it's also a genetic disease, in the sense that we Indians are more genetically predisposed to it. So officially, if you look at the data, it look like 10% of Indian adults have diabetes. That's almost 10 crore people. But India also has very poor testing and very poor surveillance. So I would say that we have to now imagine that about 20% of Indians, and it's not just urban Indians, that's a myth, a lot of rural Indians. Talk to Dr. Devi Shetty and he will tell you what a large number of rural Indians now have blood pressure, diabetes and resultant kidney problems because of that. So this is a very common condition in India. Also, in many cases, it's poorly controlled. The next thing that happens is that many people, after they are released from hospital, they go home and in the course of time come back with mucormycosis. So this is called lene ke dene pad gaye. And why does that happen? So again, doctors are saying that's happening because patients go home, they are feeling very relieved. In some cases, they continue with steroids, but in many cases, they drop their guard on blood sugar. And then this wretched thing comes back and hits you. Now, blood sugar, also remember, steroid use increases your blood sugar, particularly if you're diabetic. Steroid use immediately bumps up your blood sugar. And that's why an expert doctor then uses other methods, including insulin, to keep your blood pressure in control, blood sugar in control, because if your blood sugar is high, then your body can't deal with an infection, the infection will grow. And if blood sugar is high in these rare cases, then this fungus can also grow. So these are things to understand about. There is also a drug for it, I had mentioned to you, that is amphotericin B. It was approved in 1997. It was approved for fungal infections, but also something called leishmaniasis, which is a parasitic disease. But it's not a drug. It's an intravenously administered drug, but it's not a drug that is used all the time. Plus, it's not a drug that promises you anything. So once again, be careful. Follow your doctor's advice. I'll share a tweet with you. It is from Dr. Amrish Mittal, who's one of India's foremost diabetologists, and he put out this tweet saying that he's been treating patients, diabetics, hospitalized diabetics with COVID-19 for more than a year now. By balancing this blood sugar and steroid use, he has never seen even one case of mucormycosis. So trust your doctor, leave it to your doctor, don't be your own doctor, it is not worth it. And I promised you something on politics, so I will not hold forth for long. But just tell you two interesting trends about two major parties in the country. Now, one is this big, one is about this big, but both are major parties, BJP and Congress. So Congress today had its CWC, Congress Working Committee meeting, to lick its wounds, because these elections, while they are all celebrating that Narendra Modi and Amit Shah's BJP did not succeed in West Bengal, the fact is that Congress drew a blank, a zero in West Bengal. It did poorly in Assam. It did poorly in Kerala. It got some seats in Tamil Nadu, but that was basically by latching its wagon to its partner DMK's engine. So Congress party did some soul searching. I believe Sonia Gandhi delivered a strong message saying we must look within now. All that we'll talk about later. There are interfaction fights in Assam. Interfaction fights in Kerala are so famous for the Congress party that now they are called Congress I and Congress Congress K, etc., etc. We had spoken about it some time back. But the interesting thing is, as Mrs. Gandhi and Congress party look at the political map of India, there is a very fascinating contradiction that Congress is losing, but congressmen are winning. Congressmen and women are winning. Mamata Banerjee, former Congress, Jagan Reddy, former Congress, KCR, former Congress, although not recently, he left much earlier to join TDP. I think he left in 1983. But all these are ex-Congress people. Going to the Northeast, now the Northeast has three chief ministers who recently left the Congress to join the BJP. These are chief ministers of Arunachal, Manipur, and now Assam, since Himanta Biswa Sarma has taken over there. So I thought I'll make this point to you that Congress is losing everywhere, but it does look like a lot of congressmen are winning. Having said that, it's not as if Congress is out of the picture. If you look at the political map of India, again, a lot of states have Congress. Punjab has Congress, Rajasthan has Congress, Maharashtra, Congress is in a coalition. Chhattisgarh has Congress, Jharkhand, Congress is in a coalition. And I told you, West Bengal, Assam, Manipur, Arunachal are former Congress people, as are Vice Jagan Mohan Reddy and KCR. And even in Maharashtra, Sharad Pawar is a partner. Even in Meghalaya is a former Congress partner, that is the Sangma family. So the Congress people, leaders have some juice left in their politics, in their appeal. The problem might be the inability of the Congress leadership to hold its talent together. So that's about the Congress. What about the BJP? The interesting thing with the BJP is that for the first time in 7 years, questions are being raised from within BJP about their own government's performance. So far, BJP MPs and MLAs did not bother about this. So see the column that my colleague, our political editor D.K. Singh has written today on how so many of the elected BJP people are raising questions. In the past, as he mentions in his column, they used to say, "Arey, don't worry about all this. Modi ji to hai na. Modi ji will come and swing my election for me." But now Santosh Gangwar, who is the Union Minister for Labour and Employment, he's written a letter to Yogi Adityanath. He's the MP from Bareilly in Uttar Pradesh. And that letter has been made public, saying that the handling of the pandemic response is poor. Now, that is something that you never expected in the BJP. Some MLAs in Madhya Pradesh, Narayan Tripathi of Maihar, Arvind Giri of Gokaran Nath, have come out with complaints. Again about COVID response, Tejasvi Surya in Bengaluru, he has attacked the municipal corporation, which is run by his own party. So it is seen as an indirect attack on the chief minister. And the powerful general secretary of the party, B.L. Santosh, who comes from a strong RSS background, he's actually endorsed his action. So for the first time, don't make too much of it. Don't add a few of these straws and say there's a storm brewing in the BJP. No such thing is happening. But it's also our job to look at the straws in the wind. And these are exactly what these are. These are straws in the wind. Because, you know, particularly in UP, UP will go to elections next year. If Yogi Adityanath wins again, he'll be the first chief minister in UP in a very long time to win a second successive term after being in power for a full 5 years. Now, there are many in the BJP who already see him as a successor of Narendra Modi going ahead. Remember, he's very young. He's younger than Rahul Gandhi, younger than Arvind Kejriwal. He's very young. He's just 49 years old. So there are also internal rivalries and things. And so those voices are also coming up. So these are the stirrings in BJP that we also keep in mind.